In today's video, we're going to share three awesome graphic design techniques that few designers actually talk about, but which can breathe new life into your artwork. So grab your design tools and let's get started today. The first tip is a way to add extra depth to some of your graphic designs. Now, you might have seen designs like this, where we see a kind of a blurred glass or plastic effect on the design itself. Well, we're going to learn how to make it properly, but in Adobe Illustrator and not Photoshop. Yes, it is possible, and I think this effect looks so good when done right, and it's a great skill to have because it can actually be used in many different ways on various different designs. And actually, it's really easy to do. We first need an image or a design, and then to copy that with Command or Control C. Then, with it still selected, press Command or Control 2 to lock it down in position. And then finally, Command or Control F to paste a duplicate exactly over the top. We want to add a Gaussian blur to the duplication, and we want to add a medium kind of blur, nothing too crazy, but also nothing too mild. For the next step, you can use any sort of shape you think will work for your design, but just to quickly show you guys today, I'm going to use two rectangles to create a shape like so, and then I'm going to unite it in the Pathfinder window. I always find it really handy to have the most tools that I use just off to the panel on the right. I'm sure you agree too. But yeah, once united, I will press A for the direct selection tool and then click and drag the live corners to round off my shape. This is a personal preference and it's not necessary to do. Again, it just depends on the kind of design that you're actually working on. This next step is very, very important. Make sure you're happy with where the shape is on your composition and then copy it with Command or Control C. At this point in the process, from here onwards, don't use Command C again. Once it is copied, select the blurred layer and the object together. We're going to make a clipping mask, and that's done just like this. So we're going to make use of that copy now by pressing Command or Control F, and that will paste a duplication right over the top once more. And with this one, we're going to add a gradient, but use the freeform gradient tool. Now, if you don't have an up-to-date version of Adobe Illustrator, you can always just use a gradient mesh or even just a linear gradient. Now, we want to add multiple white nodes to the shape, especially around the edges. This will make more sense soon, don't worry. And also remove all of the other nodes that are not white just by pressing backspace when they are selected. Now, for this effect to work really well, it's wise to double-click the nodes and make some of them transparent with a low or zero opacity. Now, I do like to keep fully white nodes closer to the edges for this effect, and that's because it looks more realistic, which you will soon see later. Now, it might very well take some time fiddling around with this thing, and you can come back later to edit the gradient. But when you think you're ready, change the transparency mode to something like a soft light. And as you can see, it's starting to take shape. And like I said, all you have to do is press G with this layer selected, and the nodes will appear so you can edit the gradient again. You might also want to lower the opacity of this layer if the effect seems a bit harsh. Now we have two more crucial steps we have to do before this thing looks decent in today's video. And the first one is to again generate that duplication with Command or Control F. Now to this layer, we're going to add a texture effect by heading into the texturizer. We can use sandstone, canvas, or whatever you like really, but it is probably best to keep the relief quite low. For this layer, I'm going to use a transparency mode of Lighten. And hey presto, we now have a slight texture on this layer. Actually, let's rock with Screen for this one. It's probably a better choice. Now we're going to use one more duplication, and for this one, press Shift and X to flick that fill over to a stroke. Now press C for the scissors tool and click twice on your shape like this. And that's going to allow us to then remove an excess, which will leave a corner. Now this is really going to help the final look of this effect. Okay, now press Shift and W for the width tool. And we're going to play around with this line so it bulges a bit in the middle and closes at the each end. Now when that's ready, assign the correct stroke weight for your design, and then apply a white color to the stroke. It's important to now add a Gaussian blur, but nothing overly blurry or over the top. we can press A for the direct selection tool and move the anchor points around just like this. And in this specific instance here, I think I'm going to lower the opacity so the effect isn't too stark and too contrasting. Now you can repeat this step multiple times to add a blurred corner or some edges to this specific shape on your design. And I do really wish I had more time on my hands to make a proper design using this, but right here, this is just an example I made pretty quickly. Of course, typography does finish and complete a design. But yeah, this effect can be used for marketing and advertising, posters and designs like that, or even to make things like typography. It's a really cool technique, that's for sure. But we're now going to look at a very important graphic design theory and how you can use it on your designs. The theory in question is called the cognitive load theory, and you'll soon see why this thing is so important to know as a graphic designer. The theory states that when we're designing anything, whether it's social media posts, a website, or whatever it is, it's important to consider the cognitive load on the viewer's mind. If there's just too much information going on at once, the viewer might very well feel overwhelmed or confused, and they won't retain any of the information presented. That's not very good for our designs. To explain this theory and to demonstrate why it's so important, we're going to use social media designs as a means to express and show how cognitive theory is used on designs. Recently, I posted something to my YouTube community tab that showed 5 different typeface styles along with some information about each one of them. There were 5 in total, but instead of putting all of them onto 1 or even 2 designs, I actually gave each typeface its own design. Also, I kept the information about each typeface down to just 4 simple words. This is because I didn't want the viewer to become overwhelmed, and so I cut the information down to the raw basics. This is especially important for social media where people have a short attention span, and often people are viewing things on a small smartphone screen. But hey, let's go deeper with this. Here are 4 really useful tips for applying cognitive load theory on your social media posts or your graphic designs. Keep it simple. As we've just seen, when designing a social media post, try to keep the design and the messaging as simple as possible. Use clear, concise language and try to use as few words as possible. Instead of cramming just lots of information into one design, maybe spread it over multiple designs just like you saw earlier. Visual hierarchy. Use a visual hierarchy to guide the viewer's attention and make important information simply stand out. Use size, color, and placement to highlight the most important information. Clear-cut, easy-to-read type. Use clear-to-easy-read type to make the post easy to understand. Avoid using fancy decorative typefaces that might be difficult to read when it comes to social media posts. Use images or graphics to break up the text and make the post more visually appealing. But of course, just be sure to choose the right images and the right graphics that are relevant to the supporting message. Social media posts that actually use imagery perform a lot better compared to those that don't. So, when you're next designing something, consider the information you have to work with and will it be too much for the viewer to digest in one go? Remember, you are making visual communication. This third technique today is in Adobe Illustrator again, and it's a tool that not many people know how to use or they just don't use it at all. For much of this technique to actually work, we need text and anything along with it grouped together with Command or Control G. Now the tool in question here is the free transform tool, which you can find right here. Often people can't find the extra toolbar menu because it's actually hidden behind the tools panel. Anyway, if I go and manipulate my group like so, we can see it only edits the shape. Sure, we could actually outline the text, but that's not actually productive for a non-destructive workflow. But instead, come up to Effect and then navigate to the Free Distort, which is found here. In the new box, we can make a distortion, and hey, Adobe, if you're listening, it would be really nice to have a preview option while doing this. Just a thought. But the really cool thing about this is that, of course, the text is 100% editable. I can just come back and edit the text or change it in any way, anytime. Another cool thing we could do is to apply a twist or other distortions from the distort and transform menu. That's pretty cool, and again, the typography is editable. But let's quickly make something that actually looks half decent, right? Now I'm going to duplicate this text just by holding down the Alt Option key and clicking and dragging. This is a free font, by the way, from Fontesque. I think it's called Toronto, but yeah, I'll place the ID on screen somewhere. Now, let's add a bit of character to that text in the appearance panel by adding a slight golden glow to it. There's nothing wrong with a bit of bling now and again, of course. Then we can apply the twist effect that we saw earlier, and actually, that does look pretty cool if I don't say so myself. Distorting typography is a good technique to know, and also, now you know how to do it while keeping the text editable. A lot of resources used in today's video were actually sourced directly from Envato Elements, and it's something I personally use on a daily basis just to save time in my workflows. On Envato, there are millions of resources that designers can use on their projects, and lately, I've been grabbing a bunch of resources from the 3D section. You can even just click and rotate and choose the kind of point of view you want to download, which is pretty neat. There are tons of downloads though, and for all kinds of different projects and styles, and you can be confident using them on your designs because it's a one license fits all kind of deal when you sign up to Envato. Now you can try it for 7 days totally for free, but if you don't like it after that, you can just move on with your day as usual. And you can find Envato Elements linked in the description box below. But if you want to learn more techniques as a graphic designer, just click a video on screen. And if you have any comments or questions, just leave them in the comment section as well, and I will get down to those as soon as possible. But until next time guys, design your future today. Peace.